am a postdoctoral scholar at University of California, San Francisco, Professor of Immunology. And I'd like to start by thanking the organizers for inviting me and for putting me in the last spot as a speaker here. Because so many people here today told you about how you're going to regulate, democratize, commercialize the effects of any revolution in how we do medicine. So I think I have the pleasure to tell you one way in which you could actually get it done. So my job is to convince you that the future is today. But it actually started in 1954, so I think I need power on that. It's not catching.
Yes, thank you.
So in 1954 was the first successful organ transplant. It was a kidney transplant at the Brigham Hospital in Boston, at Harvard Medical School. And so this was arguably the first demonstration of a new concept in medicine, the idea of regenerative medicine. Regenerative medicine aims to regenerate or replace damaged organs or tissues to restitute normal function. If you think about it, most of medicine today is a lot about symptoms. If you have some ache here or there, they'll give you something that will stop that pain. But our aim is to actually get the root cause of disease and replace those damaged cells or tissues. So the idea then in regenerative medicine would be to really aim at the source of that problem. Say, if you have type 1 diabetes, your immune system attacks your beta cells that make insulin, that regulates your blood glucose levels. So if you're missing those, you might imagine going to replace those, not be on drugs to alleviate lack of insulin, etc. You want to replace the cells that are missing, and so on and so forth. And so for this, we need to know about the laws of transplant. It turns out there are laws. And so the idea is that that transplant I showed you in 1954 worked because it's between two identical twins. If we're between unrelated people, it would not have worked. And that's what summarized here in Nobel laureate's work, that if you have two mice, our favorite animals in the laboratory, if they're in the same strain, the transplant is fine. You know, it lives a long time, that's the yellow part. But if you try two mice that are not related, they're not genetically identical, you'll be rejected. Get worse than that. If you now take that same mouse again, the same recipient, and do it one more time, it gets rejected even faster. And so this is what created the idea of this immune system, and they actually processed mice over and over and over again until they only differed from one single gene locus. And that gene locus is a very cumbersome name. It is MHC, Major Histocompatibility Complex. And so what this locus codes for is this gene that codes for glycoproteins on the surface of cells. And they're like your passport holder. So a cell at any time has all these proteins inside it being processed by the proteasome. And they'll make these proteins into small pieces, peptides. These peptides are then complex with these MHC molecules, and they get presented on the surface of this cell, any cell. Virtually all cells in your body express these molecules. And so they communicate with the immune cells called T cells. T cells have a T cell receptor that can see literally inside cells. And so these T cells are trained to distinguish self from non-self. So that's why I'm saying that's overpowering that. I think my computer is over. Yeah, but there's no way.
Hey, do you want to use mics?
No, it's not. There's no way.
Is this working?
No. Oh, okay, so that's no mystery solved.
Wait.
Yeah, I just want to take it out of this one.
Even
speak. My computer.
Oh, what about that?
Try this one on the ground.
Wait,
yes.
Touch the.
Yeah. Touch it. Touch electricity.
No, that should be
on the side. Taking a big one.
Yes.
Make sure you send me all of this.
Yeah, but this one has no light either, so. Yeah, me too, there's no light. There's
no,
a bit more on the light.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And it's bolted. Yeah. If you want to design the ideal therapy, I would argue it's going to be made of cells. And so what some of us are working on right now is to use cells as living drugs. You can imagine medicine as having three pillars. So the first one would be small molecules like ampicillin or penicillin or others that will really great revolution. Small molecules, they go everywhere in your body, and they will enter any cell. The second pillar will be antibodies. So antibodies are protein molecules that in turn bind to other proteins, very specifically. And so this one's already one step up. And people thought at the time that they would not work because the field, you know, sometimes scientists are the most conservative people you could meet. And so they thought that antibodies are too big. Well, for molecules, it's not going to work. It does not follow the rules, the Lipinski rules, that a drug has to be planar and like liposoluble. Anyway, not true. Antibody is a big success. Actually, in cancer therapy, you see massive tumors just melt away when you give antibodies against specific proteins expressed on immune cells. And then I would argue that it's about time we enter the third pillar of medicine, and that's using cells, cells as living drugs. You can imagine programming cells just like you guys program a computer and tell them where to go, when to go, and what to do once they're there. So that's what I focus on, and that's what I hope I'll give you a bit of a window of where it is like working at the forefront of these ideas. Okay. Okay, so you have these molecules called MHC for short, and they will, once again, they will tell to the immune system if the cell expresses them, is self or non-self, for it. And so what this meant, though, it's a bit heartbreaking, because the idea that we could just go around and, you know, if you have a missing or a non-functional organ, you could just go to anyone and give you a functional counterpart. That's just not going to work that easily. But we might be able to make it work. So, however, right now, there is huge organ availability problems. Because you have thousands, millions of people waiting for organs, it's just a physics for a kidney. So many, many people die every year because a compatible organ cannot be found in time. And then those that are lucky enough to find an organ that is close enough to them that could be accepted, we're doing a good job with acute rejection because we pair all these different genes. But if you look at chronic rejection, less than half of the organs are still functional 10 years later. So then you, what you do, you go back to the list. So this list, if anything, just keeps growing. Because even the people who successfully get out of the list, they're going to come back into the list 10 years later. And while they're out of this list, they take up to 20 drugs, 20 different drugs every day. Because the immune system has many cell types. I could tell you all night long about the immune system. And so these drugs, for each one of them, targets a different cell type that could compromise this organ that is, you know, life-saving. And so this creates a kind of an ethical problem because where do organs come from? So what happens is that you'll see that poor countries are actually the biggest providers of organs for people in developed countries. Sometimes, you know, financial reasons, sometimes for cultural reasons. Like if you look to Japan, not many transplants happen there because it's a cultural thing. Here in the US, there's just not enough of them. So you have this kind of, you know, ethical problem with organ trafficking. So what would be a solution for this now chronic lack of organs? Well, how about we just make them? We now know, or I hope you know before that, that we all come from a single cell. And then we make a blastocyst that we implant inside your mom's womb. And inside that blastocyst, there's a structure called inner cell mass. That inner cell mass is populated by cells called embryonic stem cells. Embryonic stem cells are very special because they can give rise to every cell type in your body. And so, in theory, we could isolate these cells for a little while. And then if only we had the right recipe, we could program them to become any missing tissue that it might have. But you could also imagine, that this also offers ethical problems because you're going to have to destroy human embryos to obtain these cells. What if we could bypass that ethical problem? And a scientist from Japan actually bypassed that problem, Shin Yamanaka, Nobel Prize 2012, by inventing what's called the induced pluripotent stem cells. So what they did, they found a cocktail of four genes reprogramming factors. When you add them to adult cells, it seems to work so far with any type of adult cell that you try, even though some are easier than others to make it work. But so if you put these four transcription factors, so proteins that bind DNA and regulate how it's read inside the cell, it can turn back the clock. And so say a cell from the skin or from the blood can now become an embryonic-like stem cell. And so now you could then push this idea forward where if you have someone with some sort of disability, you could get the cells from that person and make genetically match autologous, let's say, stem cells from that person. And you can create whatever tissue is missing, and then that person will be cured. And you know, there's already a big business around this. It might not be, you know, it's not as sharp as cryptocurrency, but I would say it's still pretty exponential looking. So the idea that more and more people are getting to this space as technology becomes more and more advanced and becomes easier to make these things happen. But this still is a problem, is that you can now make your own cells or own organs, but what if there's a problem in your instructions book, in your DNA? Then if you just make more cells of yourself, they're going to have the same exact problem. That's not getting at the root of the disease. And I think the most common example of this, and I guess being an immunologist working with blood, sickle cell anemia or sickle cell disease. It was the first molecular disease to be identified. I can't really emphasize how exciting this was, because now you have one single base pair. One single base pair changes, which in turn changes one single amino acid, building block of a protein, and you see dramatic phenotype. We have a normal, happy red blood cell by concave transport function through the blood. And with this mutation, that the electricity of that amino acid makes the cells clump, and they become sickle-shaped. And you know, in some cases, people actually can die from this in less developed countries. They don't have access to the right care for this type of problem. And so what if we could just go in with like a little tiny scissors and snip out that wrong base and put in the wrong base? Right, then we get rid of the problem. And you know, this was pretty much science fiction not too many years ago, but now it's possible. It's possible thanks to CRISPR-Cas9. So CRISPR-Cas9 was actually first discovered in bacteria. That's just the way to deal with viruses. Every time a virus enters a bacterium, the bacteria takes notice and incorporates a tiny piece of that viral DNA and puts it in its own genome. So next time the virus comes in, the bacteria knows exactly where to cut and destroys that viral DNA with its scissors. In this case, scissors is Cas9 protein. And you know, I'm a human, so I care mostly about humans. And so the first demonstration that this technique, it's not a technique, but it's a biology technique, works in human cells, was provided by two different groups, was Emmanuel Charpentier and Jennifer Doudna, West Coast, and George Church and Fong Zhuang, East Coast. And you know, I think the patent battle is still going. But the important thing is that we can now do medicine with molecular precision. Just like you used to look at an x-ray and see what's wrong with this, we can now hopefully look at a DNA sequence and say, what's wrong with this? Can we give you a pill to change this problem in this DNA sequence? And so at the time I was doing my PhD back at Harvard, I was like, well, you know, if we're going to start somewhere, we're going to start with blood. Because nobody's going to give you a piece of their brain or a piece of their liver. They're going to give you a bit of blood. You know, you can take those cells out and purify them with very high precision because we have so many markers. And they all number CD1 through CD300, only I and a few people know about me. And so we start there. And so all this year, oh, everyone can do CRISPR. Sure, but it might not work. And so what I found is that actually there's a review by my roommate at the time, one of the pioneers in this field. And if you see, is that they have all these very important hallmarks, but milestones, but it had never been done before using CRISPR-Cas9 in human blood. And I thought it was easy, but apparently it turned out not to be easy. And so, my mission then at that point was to make CRISPR-Cas9 work in human blood cells. And what diseases I picked to, you know, to see if it works. I picked AIDS, which is obviously a complex disease, but you know, it affects worldwide people all over the world. We know how it's caused. It's caused by infection of a virus, HIV, which will infect your T lymphocytes, your T cells. So that's why it's so hard to cure this disease. Because this virus literally infects and destroys the cells that are meant to destroy it. So people with AIDS don't die from AIDS. They die from any infection or from cancer that they cannot fight properly because their immune system is severely compromised. So it's now become more of a chronic disease. You can't take, once again, enough drugs. We don't know a lot about the biology of this virus. So if you take enough drugs all at once, so you can block different stages at the life cycle of this viral infection and propagation. But you know, some people are luckier than that. Some people actually are born immune to each other. It's like they just want genetic library. So they did so because they have a mutation in this gene called CCR5. CCR5 codes for a protein on the surface of T cells that is required for HIV to infect T cells. So as you can imagine, without the receptor on the surface, it literally shuts the door on HIV. HIV cannot infect these people's cells. They can be carriers, they can pass it to you, but they themselves don't suffer from it. And also luckily, I guess, we have people walking around with two defective copies of this gene. So we know that this gene is not essential, at least in the modern life of the Northern European, where this occurs at like 0.01% frequency. And we knew this could be turned to a therapy because of the Berlin patient. So I don't know if you heard of this person, but the Berlin patient. still today, he is cured. Because he replaced his blood with blood that is naturally resistant to HIV because of the single mutation. And so my question is, well, can we confer this natural immunity to AIDS? You know, I feel like genome editing causes kind of paradox, like confer something that's natural, but it's true. So natural immunity, they can't confer it. And so, once again, it took some banging my head against the wall, and other people as well, we never worked away in science. But we found that if we use not one, but two guide RNAs, so CRISPR requires a guide RNA to tell it where to go in the DNA. Otherwise, it's just a blind match and it doesn't really cut. So it turns out that if you use two guide RNAs, you can't really go in. This is new interesting loss, right? So can really, you know, operate that gene. It's a, you know, so it's just a surgical intervention at the gene level. And so where do we do this? We use HSCs, hematopoietic stem cells. So it turns out there's many kinds of stem cells in your body, adult stem cells. Some of them is specialized to specific tissue. And hematopoietic stem cells, as the name indicates from the Greek or Latin, one of those two, it's a blood stem cell that regenerates your whole blood. Also it divides indefinitely. So this is the most convenient cell if you want to do this gene surgery. And so this is what we did. We got our patients, and then actually, even these cells live mostly in your bone marrow, you now have chemicals that call those cells out of the bone marrow so they come into your circulating blood. So you can collect peripheral blood and have those enriched in these blood stem cells. You purify them, you know, for example, they express E34, one of many CD markers for immune cells, and then you put in the CRISPR-Cas9, and our cat actually genetically tagged the GFP, green fluorescent protein, so it's supposed to be green, so I can't see them, so I can't purify them using flow cytometry. It's really a cool technique where you have cells inside a tube, and they go through a machine with many lasers, and then once a lot of time, goes through the laser, and the laser will tell me yes, no, yes, no, yes, and so I can purify only the green cells, only the ones that have the Cas9 inside them. And so when I do this, they become green, they warm. And so we showed that we were able to do this after all this, you know, protocol improvement that would increase with high efficiency up to 50%. They remain functional. So if you have them actually in a petri dish, they can still become many types of blood, just in a plastic dish. Also, if you put them in a mouse, in a humanized mouse, more precisely, so a mouse that doesn't have its own immune system, so I can put in my, you know, a person's immune system, you see that they can reconstitute, again, with more CD markers, we have to believe me that they show they can reconstitute several compartments of the immune system. And it does not have secondary mutations. So you could argue that's a big problem, actually, and going forward, before you use CRISPR on anyone, you have to sequence that person, because everyone's genome is different. So whatever off-targets, whatever sequence is almost like yours, it's going to cause a problem. It's going to be different from each and every one of us. And so we were very careful in this across different people, and like sequence like 3,000-fold. And we saw that there's very minimal to zero secondary targeting. So again, with this, the idea is that we could use it as a therapy for HIV. It could be a permanent cure for AIDS if you take the person's cells and do it with CRISPR. And then this important point, the different colors, because deficiency doesn't have to be 100%. Because these blood cells will be selected for. Remember, the problem to start with is that the blood cells are dying because they're infected with HIV. If when you put these cells in, they act in two ways. One, they can regenerate a whole new blood that is resistant to HIV. Number two, they're going to differentiate into T cells that will in turn recognize and kill HIV infected cells. So these cells will win by being able to grow, and they will win by killing the others. So that's, I think, an important point, once again, an advantage in blood versus other tissues. So you put them in and then make that a therapy. And so we actually have, there's a clinical trial with this strategy going on in China right now, and we licensed. It's like the Mustang Bios in Massachusetts. So what I want to share with you in the last three slides is that we don't have to stop here. You know, I'm an immunologist, and unfortunately I can't really tell you what I'm doing, but let's just say that I still do a lot of immune cell engineering, and I'm attempting to re-educate the recipient's immune system to accept a foreign organ itself. So, you know, there are specific cells of cells that can go after specific sets of genes. But I just want to tell you that this does not have to relate to the blood. There's actually a very cool paper that came out recently from Europe. There was a kid with a terrible genetic disease that the skin basically falls apart from the day it's born. It just comes off. But we know what the mutation is. So you can take pieces of healthy skin that remains, isolate the skin stem cells, skin also has stem cells, and edit that gene. And you can grow these big sheets of skin entirely in the lab. And actually
actually the patients in Germany, and they sent these cells to Italy, different country. And they grew the skin there, shipped it back to Germany, and now he's cured. You see, they just apply the skin to different parts of his body, and he's cured. And actually, they even saw that, much like in the blood, there was a clone, a single cell, that was able to give rise to a whole patch of the skin, and they sequenced it. They can do lineage tracing and tell where it came from. So this is the first demonstration, just a few months old. First demonstration, outside of the blood, of an adult stem cell, giving rise to an entire adult tissue. And you can imagine doing that elsewhere. So, but so far I've told you about being his own cells. What if you want to really democratize this, make this available for more and more people? Maybe you want to make those cells universal. So you could just have a therapy off the shelf. Anyone can go and take these cells that are very good at making cardiac tissue, or pancreas, or liver. So what we did was, going back to this MHC machinery, there's this gene, beta microglobulin, that if you delete it, MHC cannot make it to the surface anymore. So these cells become invisible to the immune system. And so we did some experiments with this again in mice, and what we see is that if you engineer stem cells and then implant them into mice, you see how if you delete this gene, either one copy or both copies, there's a dramatic decrease in the rate of rejection. And so what this shows is that this is a first step forward, the creation of universal cells that could be off-the-shelf cellular therapies for many kinds of diseases, ones missing specific types. But in the future, just use stem cells to make organs like by delivery. You know, if you have the right scaffold, you can just make a kidney or a liver in the lab. And you can ship that to anyone because they're universal. So the same thing, the same way that you have a universal blood donor now, can donate blood to everyone, I want a day where we have universal regenerative medicine. We have stem cells that are, you know, they have been through all the quality controls, they're very good at making a specific cell type or organ, and they're compatible with everyone. And so I think that's where medicine should go. Instead of curing symptoms, it will really cure the root cause. And we'll go to that to everyone. Thank you.